Hi there. Today we're going to take a look at how we can use the built-in events in Phaser 3 to know when an animation is completed. So the Phaser 3 framework has a number of events that will be emitted when certain things happen in your game. And one of these events is an animation completed event. And with this event, you can provide event listeners that you want to run when this event fires. And so this is a mechanism to have a hook to know when this event is completed so that we can run your own logic. And so if you can imagine, you might want the ability to know when an animation is completed so you can use that as a trigger in your game. So as an example on the screen here, we have a very simple Phaser 3 scene that is playing this lightning strike animation. And what's happening is every time this lightning strike finishes, we are listening for that event and we are just incrementing a counter and logging that to our web console. All right, and so to follow along, there will be a link to the starter code in the description of this video, and there'll also be a link to the completed source code in the description as well. All right, and so before we dive into the code, I just want to go ahead and take a moment to give credit to where this lightning strike animation came from. So this was created by Essam, and it's part of the Rocky Roads asset pack that's available on itch.io. So there'll be a link in the description of this video to this asset pack where you can download that. All right, if you want to go ahead and follow along, go ahead and download the starter code now, and go ahead and extract those files and open them in an IDE of your choice. So in the starter code, there's going to be just a bare bones Phaser 3 game instance. Under the assets folder, there's going to be the lightning sprite sheet that we'll be using for our animation. The index.html will be our main entry point to our web application. It just has some minor styling in the Phaser 3 library, and then it just points to our main.js file. And so this is where our main logic is going to live. And so inside here, we just have a basic Phaser 3 game instance that we create, and we create a very basic scene. And right now we are loading in our sprite sheet with the frame width and height for the individual frames. We're creating our basic animation for the lightning strike. And then we go ahead and we create our sprite game object and we play the animation one time. So if you want to go ahead and start your local web server, and once the scene starts, the lightning should strike after a small delay. All right, so to go ahead and listen for your animation completion events, there's two different ways we can do this. There is a generic animation complete event that will fire anytime any animation in your game is completed, and you can listen to this event. So if you only have one animation, this is an easy one you can key off of. The second method is you can listen for an animation event that will be tied to the animation key that's provided when you create your animation. All right, so to see an example of this, what we're going to do is right above our lightning where we play our animation, we're going to go ahead and listen for the animation completion event. So if we do lightning and we do on and we do phaser animations events, and then we want to do the animation complete event. And so when we register our event listener, we need to provide our callback function that'll be invoked when this event fires. And all we're going to do for the time being is we're just going to do a console log and we're going to do animation complete. So if we go ahead and save, what we should see is when our animation is finished, we should see our console log in our browser console. So as I mentioned, if you only have one animation, this event will work fine for your needs. However, if you have multiple animations, you might want to key on a specific one. And so to do that, what we need to do is we'll do our sprite. We'll do on to provide our event listener. And we're going to do phaser.animations.events.animationCompleteKey. And so this is a prefix for the event that'll be fired. And so this prefix here we have to update it to include our animation key that we provide when we created our animation. So what we'll do is we'll just do plus, and then we're going to go ahead and copy our key here that we use for our animation. And then we're going to go ahead and provide our callback for when this event fires. So we're just going to do console.log. We're just going to do test. So now when our animation plays, we should see two console log statements. We see the animation complete and our test. All right, so now that we know which events we need to listen for, we can actually add in some game logic to modify our animation. So we're actually doing something when this animation triggers. So what we're going to do in this example is we're going to go ahead and increment a counter for how many times our lightning strikes. We're also going to go ahead and move our sprite. So then that way we can create an effect like lightning is striking in different locations. And so to do that, what we'll do is inside our callback here for when our lightning strikes, the first thing we're going to do is let's make a variable for our counter. We're going to set it equal to 0. Inside here, we're going to do counter plus equals 1. And then we're going to update our console log statement. So instead of test, what we'll do is we'll do lightning strike. And then we're just going to add in our counter so we can see the amount. Then what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and move our sprite to a random location. So to do that, we'll reference our sprite game object, and we're going to go ahead and call set frame. We're going to reset our animation back to the initial frame. So when our animation finishes, it stays at the last frame it was set to. So by going back to that first frame, we set ourselves up for that animation. And then we're going to go ahead and call set X. And so to provide a random X position, we're just going to use the built-in phaser math utility. So we'll do phaser.math.between. And what this allows us to do is provide two values, a min and a max, and we'll get a random integer that's between those values inclusive. So if we do 100 and 700, that should keep our game object within the bounds of our canvas so we can see it. And then, so what we'll do is we're going to go ahead and save. We should see that after that completes, our animation does move. What I'm going to go ahead and do is let's go ahead and get rid of our delay. And then that way this plays a little bit faster. All right, much better. So now that has a bigger move, so it's easier to see. So now we see, once our animation is done, we're now moving our sprite game object. However, because our first frame is visible, what we're going to do is we're just going to modify the alpha so that it looks like the lightning will be striking from the top again. So what we'll do is we'll do set alpha, and we'll go ahead and save. And then it just kind of looks like the lightning disappears, and then we're getting ready for our next lightning strike. So to do our next lightning strike, what we're going to do is we're going to go ahead and just restart our animation with a slight delay. And so what we'll do is we'll do this.time. And what this allows us to do is we can add some time utility methods that are in phaser, and we can do a delay call. And what this will do, it allows us to specify a callback that will be invoked after so many milliseconds that we provide. So we're just going to do 800 milliseconds. All right, and then we need to specify our callback. So then in our callback, what we're going to do is we'll update the alpha for our lightning sprite game object. That way it'll show on the screen. And then we're going to go ahead and play our animation. So we're going to go ahead and reference the animation key that we used, which just happened to be our sprite sheet asset name. And so now what should happen is our animation should complete. We should go ahead and move our sprite game object, play it again, move it, play it again. Perfect. And so one last thing we're going to do is we're just going to change our animation event here from on to once, so we only fire this one time. All right, perfect. And so that brings our demo to an end. So as you can see, with just a few lines of code, we can create some very nice effects by listening for that animation completion event and then doing some type of logic in our game, such as moving our game objects or incrementing a counter. So just as a reminder, there'll be a link to the completed source code in the description of this video. As always, thank you so much for watching. I hope you enjoyed the content. If you did, please consider subscribing or liking the video. If you'd like to see more great Phaser 3 content, please see some links on your screen now. And if there's any topics you'd like to see covered, please feel free to leave a comment.